Yeah, so thank you for the opportunity. So today I will talk about robotic assisted living donor nephrectomy and I'm gonna start with a very basic concept. So why and how we should do it? So the reason why we should do it is because, you know, every time we have a person who would like to donate an organ, a kidney in this particular case, we strongly believe that we should make it happen. So donation usually starts with a strong desire, and it creates an incredible bond between the donor and the recipient. So for this reason, we strongly believe that as long that there are no medical contraindication, no technical or anatomical contraindication should stand in the way of the donation. And at the same time, donation by definition should be the safest procedure that we perform. It should provide cosmetically appealing results, minimal pain, optimal function of the donor, short hospital stay, and then of course it should preserve the function and the integrity of the graft that we transplant. So in order to provide all these features, so we think that we should use the best technology available. As everybody's pretty familiar, I'm sure, so the first minimal invasive nephrectomy was performed by Dr. Radner in 1995. And initially they were able to show not inferior outcome results between minimal invasive nephrectomy and the largest series of open nephrectomy for living donation. And then of course, you know, when the surgeon became more used to the procedure, more competent, of course they were able to show better results in terms of hospital stay and outcome. And this became very appealing for the population because they had the chance to donate an organ with a minimal pain, a very short hospital stay, and very important for a healthy person with a very good cosmetic results. And I call this slide the robotic transition. Is not really a transition because we know that laparoscopic nephrectomy is still the standard of care for donor nephrectomy and is part of the ESTS curricula. But in August 2000, so the group led by Dr. Benedetti performed the first laparoscopic donor nephrectomy. And I would like to cover the reason, the rationale to start applying the robotic technology to nephrectomy. Well, we all know the features of the robot. The end of wrist makes, you know, the dissection very easy, especially in the presence of difficult anatomies and multiple arteries. We have the magnification of the surgical field and the 3D vision in the surgical field. We have a stability of the camera that we control through the console, and we have a shorter learning curve than laparoscopy. All these features, they came to a hand when they had the vision to start robotic nephrectomy. And I think that nowadays they are even more important because the population or the donor population is growing more obese. And I want to add another point. So there are many centers where the robotic nephrectomy, the laparoscopic nephrectomy, I'm sorry, is still performed by the minimal invasive division or the minimal invasive urologist. And the reason is mostly because as transplant surgeon, most of us, we had a maximally invasive training. So we are used to big operation, we are used to multi-organ procurement, big incision. And then of course, you know, the moment we approach the minimal invasive world and we try to apply it in transplantation, so we wanna use the best technology with the shorter learning curve. And we strongly believe that actually the robot provided all this benefit all in once. And talking about the technique, so I mentioned before that we think that the robot is better, definitely not inferior, but probably better whenever we have to deal with multiple arteries and let's say aberrant anatomy. So that's why I want to show you a couple of videos. So in this video, we have two arteries. We have a lower pole and a main renal artery, and we have a retroaortic renal vein. And this is how we perform the procedure. We always start with the mobilization of the colon that we can see here. So we expose the iliopsoas muscle to identify the ureter in its medial portion. After the ureter is identified, we encircle the ureter with a Penrose that we use to facilitate the dissection and for retraction. At this point, we identify the gonadal vein that we follow in a distal to proximal direction in order to identify the renal vein. In this particular case, you can see that the renal vein is a typical caudal to cranial course simply because it's retroaortic. So usually the takeoff is a little bit lower than a regular renal vein. And as you can see here, we can see the lower pole artery crossing the gonadal vein and almost the renal vein itself. Then we keep dissecting proximally to identify the adrenal vein. That is there. So once it's identified, both the adrenal and the gonadal vein are transected between hemologs. So gonadal is transected. And the adrenal is transected as well. I hope these videos are not long, but I know that this platform is particularly interesting for all the media that we share. So I hope that these are helpful for the audience. At this point, we transect the ureter. We mobilize the kidney immediately after we finish the hilar dissection. You can see the hand of the assistant in the field. And maybe I can. Okay, so now the kidney is medially mobilized. The dissection continues. Let me move this a little bit faster. So here we have the two arteries that we can see here and the vein that are ready to be transected. So we start the transection of the accessory lower pole. We continue with the main renal artery. And then finally the vein, and as we can retrieve the graft. So some tips and tricks from a pure technical standpoint. So we know that the common anatomical variation are the presence of accessory upper or lower pole, or in this case, like retroaortic renal vein. So usually we suggest to not lose the natural exposure of the provided by the contraction of the gonadal and the adrenal vein to dissect them both before transecting them. Because otherwise, if we transect one and we start dissecting the other, that's going to be more difficult. And another thing, usually we prefer to dissect the ileum entirely before starting mobilizing the kidney, because otherwise the kidney literally will fall into the ileum, and the dissection will be more troublesome. And in the presence of retroaortic renal vein, we have to consider that sometimes the artery can cross in the anterior wall of the vein. So we have to be very careful during the dissection. And now I'm going to show you briefly a right nephrectomy in the presence of adhesion for an open cholecystectomy. So we start in the same manner. So we mobilize the colon.
Mario, sorry to intervene.
Yeah.
Please skip at the time. So okay. If you need to show the video, do it very fast, okay?
Okay. So we saw before the IVC dissection and the dissection of the renal vein. Here we perform with scissor the adhesiolysis. At this point, it's very important in the right nephrectomy to flip the kidney medially and to fully mobilize the IVC, because this is going to give us a better exposure in the artery. And sometimes we're able to dissect a good portion of the artery actually behind the IVC. So we can definitely gain some land there. And here we see the dissection of the artery, transection of the ureter, and finally we stapler the artery and the vein, and we retrieve the organ. I think I can. Okay. And again, so probably the key of the right nephrectomy is the full immobilization of the IVC to have a better access to the artery. And just another details, technical details. So end assistance, some center, they like to do it pure minimal invasive. We still advocate for the end assistance. And the reason why we keep doing that is simply because we think that every donor procedure at the end of the day will become a hybrid procedure, because we have to open up funnel still or any kind of service incision to retrieve the organ. So we like to do it sooner rather than later, simply because we strongly believe that the present in the field of an expert experienced hand can be very helpful when we have difficult anatomy, obesity, or even if you want to set the threshold for conversion higher, because if we get in any kind of bleeder, a good assistant can literally stop the bleeder when we exchange the instrument and we literally decide what we're going to do next. So now we can move to our experience. So we recently published our experience on Annals of Surgery, and the experience, as I mentioned before, was started in August 2000, and we published about 1,000 cases. The conversion rate was 0.6%, and all the cases that were converted happened at the really beginning of the experience, in the first 5 years. We did 95% of left nephrectomy, and in 24% of the cases we had arterial anatomy variation. And unfortunately, we had one fatality for a congenital hypogammaglobulinemia in a patient that donated to his twin that unfortunately struggled himself with a severe sepsis for the same reason, but the recipient recovered. Talking about the donor demographics, so the majority of our donors are female, about 55%. And ethnicity-wise, this is a good picture of the population that we serve here in the Chicago area. So 36% of our donors are African-American, followed by 27%, 31% that are Hispanic, and 27% that are Caucasian. So this picture about the BMI probably, you know, is a reflection of what happened over the last 20 years, but probably if we check by decades, we would see probably more obese and morbidly obese patients. Anyway, since we started, 35% of the patients were overweight, 25% were obese, and about 15% of our patients are morbidly obese. I'm sure that nowadays are more than that. In terms of vascular variation, in 25% of our cases, we had two arteries, and in 3%, we had either 3 or 4 arteries. And about the hospital outcome. So the warm ischemia time with the robotic approach has been pretty much steady from the beginning, and it's about 3 minutes. The surgical duration, of course, improve over time. And intraoperative blood loss has always been minimal, and we transfuse only for patients for the reason that I explain later in the outcome. The length of stay, the median length of stay is 3 days, but nowadays usually our patients stay in the hospital. If they are very young and they're willing to go, usually they stay 1 day, sometimes they stay two. And this is the complication by the Clavien classification. As you can see, we had 0.2% of grade 4 complication, and we have one grade 5, that is the mortality that I mentioned before. So the grade 4 complication were two intra-abdominal hematoma that required a laparoscopic washout. We had a hemoperitoneum due to an epigastric artery bleeding that required a fixing and a hematoma washout. And then we had a bowel perforation that was fixed on postoperative day one. The other complications are minor complications, and in total, the complication rate within 30 days, it's about 17%. That is absolutely in line with what is reported now in the largest laparoscopic nephrectomy series. And we stratify our study by BMI classes to see if there is any impact of the BMI in the outcome of our donor. And as we can see here, highest BMI patients usually are female and usually are African Americans. If you are talking about the operative variables, so the OR time actually isn't changed, and no difference were noticed in the warm ischemia time, EBL, transfusion rate, or length of stay. So I think we can state that the BMI doesn't impact the outcome results of the robotic nephrectomy. And for this reason, I conclude that robotic living donor nephrectomy is a safe technique which offers the advantage of a short learning cure, shorter operating time, fast patient recovery, and we think better outcomes. And we strongly believe that the robotic nephrectomy is an excellent technique, especially with the high BMI recipient and with anatomical variation. Thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to answer some questions.
Thank you, Mario, for the presentation. Yeah, we have been lucky enough that we didn't see another conversion or blood transfusion since 2006. So the learning curve has been in the initial years, and now we have a very good operation. Can I ask if there is any question? I see
some
Dr. Vinay Kumarar. Can we ask the organization to allow Dr. Kumarar to ask his question live? Dr. Kumaran, please go ahead.
Actually, your question was answered later on. I was just asking about the warm ischemia time, and the slide came up later, and I saw the warm ischemia time is 3 minutes.
So, all right.
It's 3 minutes, and
during your talk, thank you.
It really hasn't changed over time, and I think we have a very standardized way of doing this procedure, so that's probably why. And.
All right, so we have a few other questions. Dr. Sameh Fayel, would you like to ask your question? Otherwise, I can read it. He's asking if we perform donor robotic assistant surgery with hand in from the beginning of the case. Mm-hmm. And the second question is about the max BMI that we accept.
Yeah. So talking about the hand assistance, as I mentioned before, yes, we use the hand assistance from the beginning through a funnel still. And the reason is because, again, the kidney has to come out somehow, somewhere. And everybody take it out from a funnel still. So our point is why we don't put the hand inside from the beginning, because this is going to be very helpful for the exposure, especially in obese patients when we have to deal with a lot of bowel, and having a good hand inside, that's very helpful. It's going to make, you know, your operation go smoothly. And then at the same time, I think that the point is the threshold for conversion. So when you have to deal with the bleeders, sometimes it can happen, not often, but sometimes it may happen. If you have an expert hand inside that can tamponate the bleeding, then you can start, you know, making a plan. You can change your instruments, you can prepare your stitch, you have time. You don't have to rush to convert because you're in a situation that you have to fix quickly and you don't have, you know, the strategies, I mean, a system in place. So that's why we do it from the beginning. We don't see honestly any reason why it should be done later, just at the time of the graft retrieval, because that incision has to be done anyway, right? And talking about the BMI cutoff, so we recently set a BMI cutoff of 45, but please, Dr. Benedetti, correct me if I say anything wrong.
No, 45 is the right answer.
And that's our cutoff. So usually, you know, we know that we are dealing with a small group of patients that are obese, but otherwise very healthy. And there is a nice study from Doris Sager that actually tried to describe in a very epidemiological way, you know, the outcome results of this patient.
It's Mario, we have many other questions.
Okay,
Let's try to answer as many as possible. I'm going to allow three more questions. And I start with Ellen van Etelvelde. What is the trocar placement?
Okay, so the trocar placement. So we keep the, I'm talking now about a left nephrectomy. So the patient is in a right flank position. So we put one robotic arm in the left subcostal space, very high. Then we put the camera pretty much at the level of the midline, facing the kidney ilum. So we fill the kidney from inside and we put the camera about, you know, 10 centimeter towards the midline. So the second robotic arm goes in the left patient flank at the same line, pretty much, you know, the mid clavicular line, in the same line of the first robotic arm. And then we put the assistant trocar that is a 12 millimeter in the left iliac fossa.
Very good. So there is another interesting question from Dr. Qiang Liu. Any cost-effective analysis? This one I'll answer because we took care of it before Mario's time. So we did initially a cost-effective analysis comparing robotic donor nephrectomy to open, and it's a clear-cut win for the robot despite the additional cost of the procedure, because we save a length of stay that was back then 3 days less on the robotic side. The same, of course, all true for laparoscopy. When we compare laparoscopic versus robotic donor nephrectomy in our hospital, we found a comparable cost. The reason is we don't use very sophisticated instruments. We just use the hook and the bipolar. One of the person in the audience was asking, can you use energy device? Dr. Kadiala Raivin, can we use the new energy device to divide the vein instead of clip? Of course you can, but then you add cost to the procedure. We believe that the robotic clip are easy to apply, they have a 360 degree rotation, and they're very safe. And we keep also an eye on the cost. And if we do with this simple baseline instrument, no energy device, just the hook and the clips, we actually are comparable at the cost of laparoscopy in our hospital, which we like to have to continue the support of the administration. I'm going to go through one more question, and then Dr. Spaggiari will respond by text to the individual questions that are not been replied yet. Dr. Asher Zimmerman, by requiring hand inside and someone on the console, do you always do these cases with two attendings?
We usually the hand assistant most of the time is our fellow, they become very proficient because we do many of those cases. So we like to actually attend this sometimes, but is not a rule. Then the assistant, I mean, it's something that can be done by a very proficient fellow. So maybe the first year we don't allow them, we teach them, and the second year they can be already, you know, excellent assistant.
Last question that I'm going to address is from Juan Carlos Caicedo. How do you assess the long-term risk of morbid obese prior to donation? That's a great question, Juan Carlos. So first of all, we use only IOXL to check the GFR of potential donor, which, as you know, is considered the most accurate system currently available. And we are very conservative in accepting only donor with excellent GFR documented by IOXL. We have a transplant nephrology consultation before that point out to them the risk linked to the obesity, either direct or indirect, regarding our kidney function. We have a social worker as well as the patient representative that pretty much go once more over the risk inherent to being obese and donating one kidney. So we try to be as open as possible and try to be as selective as possible from the standpoint of the renal function and the overall operative risk. I hope I answer, otherwise we can continue offline. At this point, I will ask Dr. Spaggiari to respond to the remaining question directly by text. Mario, please take care.